Okay, so thank you very much for inviting me here. So this is my first time in Brazil, and I will talk on some common project with Corrado De Concini and Claudio Progessi. So we have several papers which are published on Archive and which have something in the title, which is I am sorry, I modified the title. So it has in the title there is something on splines, and I will insist on in this lecture I will insist a little bit on splines because I like them, and we will see that some analogy on. With construction of, with multiplicity of group representation and what people call splines in numerical analysis. So so what is the aim of our work? And so this is something which is familiar probably to most of you, that in fact multiplicities of representations of compact groups, if you have a representation of a compact group which is constructed by some geometric way, then the multiplicity of this non-irreducible representation, let's say it's for example L2 of G, then the multiplicity of the representation is the dimension of V lambda, which is a polynomial function on lambda. So in some sense, many of the functions, many of the multiplicities of the representation, their multiplicities are polynomial functions in a sense that I will explain. So they will be piecewise quasi-polynomial functions on G hat. So this I will explain what I mean. And my interest is also on the index theorem, that in fact you can really give an index theorem directly you can construct what we call the infinitesimal index formula, which means that we construct directly the multiplicity function from the symbol of the operator. And also, we were interested to deduce from the knowledge of the index the structure of several equivariant K-groups. So I will discuss at the end that, because this is not completely finished. So what do I do with that? I push here. The next page. What is the next page? I want the next page. Okay. So next
word. Right.
Okay. So as I said, we have encountered very often piecewise quasi-polynomial function in studying multiplicity for group representation. In fact, this is something. So I first discuss what I mean by a quasi-polynomial function on a lattice. So what is a quasi-polynomial function on a lattice? So first, the restriction of a polynomial function is a polynomial function on the lattice. This is what we call polynomial. And if you have a closed polyhedral cone, rational, defined by some inequations which are rational, and if we have a z-valued function, polynomial function on lambda, you can restrict this polynomial function on the cone, and this will called, again, it will call the quasi-polynomial, it will call a piecewise quasi-polynomial function. So piecewise means that you just piecewise, it will be defined by an equation on a set defined by an equation, otherwise zero. And if you have a function which is a sum of such functions, we will call that a piecewise polynomial function. We can also translate this function by a lattice element, and it's again piecewise polynomial. And unfortunately, we have to allow not only polynomial functions, but we have to allow functions which are polynomial tensor function which comes from a finite quotient of lambda and lambda zero. So that means on each coset of a lattice, there are polynomials. And it's interesting to understand exactly what function arise, but for the moment, you can think of it as a just polynomial function restricted to cones. And so an example, this is f of k on the z. Then you give a polynomial formula, k plus 1, k plus 2 over 2, and you restrict it for k greater than 1, otherwise 0. And this is an example of piecewise quasi-polynomial function on z. So let's give this simple example, but which occurs all the time, is that you consider a vector space V, Cn, and you act by homotacy. So the decomposition under homotacy of this space is just the homogeneous polynomial of degree k. This will be the representation corresponding to the character e power I k theta of S1, so a function which transforms by e power I k theta. And then this infinite dimensional vector space then breaks up into this sum of characters of S1. And the multiplicity is this function k plus 1, k plus 2, k plus n minus 1 over n factorial minus 1, which takes, so this is the dimension of the ring of homogeneous polynomial on Cn. And so you see this basic function on k, which is invented by Pascal or something like that, which are the arising in binomials. And so some other example where you can encounter quasi-polynomial function. If you take the representation of highest weight representation, representation with highest weight lambda of a compact group K and which has maximal torus T, and you look at this function, the lambda goes to the dimension of the zero weight space. Then again, this is a locally quasi-polynomial function. You have to divide the cones of dominant weights in a certain number of other cones, and you can write this function as polynomials on some subsets of cones when you have a restriction to subset of cones. And the same thing for Clebsch-Gordan coefficient and so on. So we have seen many quasi-polynomial functions in our life. So I was interested to understand the piecewise polynomial behavior of multiplicities and so on. And in fact, it's a little bit shameful, but many things had been done by I studied a lot the partition function, the constant partition function. And I discovered only, I don't know, 10 years ago that not a lot of theorems were obtained by people in numerical analysis on these kind of functions. And so I want to discuss the problem which was arising in numerical analysis and the solution, which I call the Riemann-Roch theorem for splines. Of course, it's not called that, like that by in the books of numerical analysis. It's usually called the deconvolution formula. And I want to understand how this kind of same ideas can be used to construct functions associated to any elliptic or even transversally elliptic G-invariant operator on manifold, and to produce from this data piecewise polynomial function. And the third part is to try to describe all the possible multi-splines so obtained. So, my first part will be just purely very simple things on splines, but which are quite old, but I feel I want to somewhat popularize this. And the second part will be how to get spline associated to any G-invariant elliptic operator. And the third part will be to try to understand the space of splines so obtained. So what is a spline? It's a function which is just, here I put, I don't remember. Yes, I put here the discontinuity at half integers. So this has, I will explain later. So basically it's a function which is on each interval, either intervals which endpoint integers or half integers, are made of just restriction is a polynomial. We'll see. No, we'll see. I'll give you an example. You have of course. So what is the problem? It's interesting to read what write Bézier on this problem. So it was a numerical analysis problem, which was solved for car design. So you had the car design, what is called a maquette, what a prototype, which was drawn by somebody. But then you had to reproduce this drawing in many different to many different people. And it seems that when you were reproducing this drawing, then the doors will not close and so on, because there will be some slight change in the reproduction of the drawings and so on. And this was the idea that you had to have a way to encode drawings. So, and it has been immediately employed on a lot of things, and in particular in tech and all the fonts problem. I mean, not immediately, but let's say it is. So we have to have a drawing, and we have to code this drawing and to send it to a lot of places. So these are the drawing. These are the little piece you will use. And in fact, it seems that they use only this last one, B3 of Y. So the drawings here, if it is odd, it has a discontinuity. I put them center at zero, so the interval is minus one half, interval of length one. And then the linear one, you see that it has discontinuity at integers, and so on. So if you are B1, it's a discontinuity. Bm has discontinuity at odd integers, and B2 has discontinuity at integers, otherwise one half and so on. So you have this. For example, this is a little the little B3, which is, I think, the only one which is used, in, if I understand. And it is quadratic, so that means it will be C1. It's quadratic on each piece, and the derivative matches. And this is a drawing. I will give a... So this is a drawing of the function. And then, maybe the definition of the box spline will be more familiar to you because by Fourier transform, because the Fourier transform of this function is some function that you should recognize, which is sine x over x, and the power of this. And for example, then the function sine x over x, we all know how to integrate e power I x y dy over the minus 1/2 over 1/2, and this gives this. This is the function. So now we want to construct and deconstruct splines. So we take one of these little model, and we translate and multiply them by a weight. So we obtain a space of polynomial function of piecewise polynomial function on R. So it's a function which is smooth even more. It's polynomial except at integer points if m is odd, if m is even. And except at half integer points if m is odd. And you can characterize the space of functions so obtained by the fact that you obtain any kind of function with some cm minus 1 with this property being polynomial of degree m minus 1 on each interval, and with continuity m minus 2 then. And the reverse problem is how to... F is the drawing, and we want to construct P, which is coding. And so we want to reconstruct M from P. So I return back to my first example, this polynomial function, this spline function that I get. And here I have taken P, so one, I mean, I take random things, 1, 4, 4, 1, 1, 1, 1. So you see that there are some pieces which are completely flat. For example, when you have 1, 1, 1, 1, then it makes a flat piece, and you can obtain linear, and you can obtain something like that. But now we want to reconstruct P from that. So you would think that P has something to do with the value of the function, but it's not exactly right. So I write the value of the function in the bottom line. So you see that the 1, 1, 1 reproduce somewhere, but not exactly with the same length, and so on. So the value, you cannot just take the value of the spline function yourself. It's not bad, because you can see that it has more or less the same behavior, but you it's not exactly that. So you have to do a quantum correction to obtain the P. You just cannot take the value of F. And here, the Todd operator will do the trick. So you look at the inverse of the box spline. You look at this function, x over sine x power m. You raise it in, you look at this Taylor series at the origin, and you, then x, you replace it by d over dy. So you obtain this infinite differential operator with a series of constant coefficient differential operator. And remark that it operates on polynomial function on y, because if your function is degree 2, then when r is greater than 2, then it will give 0 in this thing. So you can apply it to polynomial function of y. So I start. So this is a theorem. You take a function f of y that you have, so function which is polynomial on each interval and has some continuity properties, cm minus 1, I'm sorry, CM minus 2, I think. So, and you want to recuperate the P from that. So the same equations, I write the same equation that the same equation is below. If you take the Fourier transform of this equation, then the Fourier transform of Bm is this function, 2 sine x over 2 over x. And so you have an equation by Fourier transform. And the theorem, which is quite old, is that you can recuperate this weight by differentiating the function f of y by the Todd operator. So it is f of y plus a certain constant d over dy squared, because it is f of y. And it's quite remarkable that if you do that, then the function is really, you can, this function is continuous at the integer. Where you want to, you can do from a left of or right limit is the same. So you recuperate your weight this way. You differentiate your function where it is a polynomial, and then you look at the limit from left of right, and it is correct. And there is the same theorem by Damen-Michaeli for multi-splines, and of course is. I don't want to write the theorem, and so we, with the Concini processi, we wrote a theorem for some kind of multi-splines, which is on this of this kind of theorem. For on here, I do the theorem. This is in R, just one-dimensional splines. But you can, of course, do multiple splines on vector spaces, and you have the same kind of theorem. So I don't resist to the pleasure to give a wrong proof. And so because somewhat it's quite easy to understand the idea of the proof. So you want to solve this equation, no? You want to write this equation by Fourier transform, so it's quite natural to try to solve by Fourier transform, because you know the Fourier transform. So you rewrite this equation, you invert, you want to recuperate the P of K, so P of K is on the left side, so you put everything on the right side. Okay, so we see what we want to do, huh? Okay, so I was at this place, and here you are annoyed because this function is not really well defined everywhere on X. It's defined, it has some poles. So you just replace the function by its Taylor series. So then you have a function which is defined everywhere. And now if you were having a polynomial, you will know how to solve. Because if you were having a polynomial, you integrate by part. And this polynomial is d over dy, is p over d over dy over e power minus ix. And you put it you apply integration by part, and you obtain this equation. And here you have an equation of, you see, Fourier transform, let's say, and you look at this equation at the integers, and the result is correct. So, of course, here I have done several, but it's correct, and you can use the Poisson formula, and of course, a particular property of this function sine x over x power m to really get the formula. But I think this kind of equation where on the left side you have a discrete series, you have a discrete sum of characters, and on the other, on the right side you have an integral formula. This kind of formula arises in many examples. For example, if you look at the character of SL2 and the product of characters of SL2, then the Kirillov formula will tell you that it is on this. You have to look at the. It will be giving exactly this formula. So you have on the left side you have something discrete, and on the right side you have an integral, and you want to recuperate the p of k. And so you know that p of k is obtained by differentiating this function f of y by a differential operator. So it will be a local operator. So that means if you know f of y near the point where you want to prove something, you will know your p of k. So again, again, this is the way that multiplicity, the behavior of partition, constant partition function like quasi-polynomial, it's somewhat an old theorem of Damen-Michaeli on this inversion of splines. So now I want to discuss elliptic operators. So I shift a little bit of, this is the spline part was some kind of motivation. I mean, some kind of, more than motivation, some kind of giving some ideas of what you should do to prove some quasi-polynomiality. So there are many constructions of representation, like L2 index of a Dirac operator on Riemannian symmetric spaces, or quantization of symplectic manifold with proper Marmad map, which leads to representation of compact groups, and eventually infinite dimensional representation, but each multiplicity of an irreducible representation has a finite multiplicity. So I give the example, which is you look at the manifold M, T star of G. So G is compact. And you look at left and right action of G cross H, where H is a subgroup of G. Then the quantization of T star of G is L2 of G. And you obtain this formula, lambda mu, m lambda mu, v lambda g, tensor v mu of h star. So that means this m lambda mu, which is a multiplicity of the representation v mu of the group h in the restriction of v lambda g to h, is one example of representation occurring by quantizing a symplectic manifold. And you have the multiplicity here. And so I would like to have a theorem for multiplicities of representation constructed geometrically, and in some sense to have directly from the operator D and more or less of its symbol, to construct directly from the symbol of D a function on G, on the dual of G, a function on the space on G hat. And of course, in these topics, I have been very interested in the so-called quantization with reduction theorem, which concerns the quantization of symplectic manifold, and which relates the multiplicity to another important quasi-polynomial function, which is the Duisternmatt-Ekman measure, which if you have a symplectic manifold and you have a moment map under a compact group action, then you know that the description of the image is given by some kind of polyhedral region. If you describe the multi, if you want to understand the image of the moment map, it's the G star of G is parametrized by the Weyl chamber, and you obtain piecewise polynomial function on the Weyl chamber, and the multiplicities are not exactly the Duisterman function, but the Duisterman function with some quantum correction. So you don't look, if you want to, you quantize the simple eclectic manifold, you have the Duisterman measure, you have the Duisterman measure takes some values at integral points, but usually the value it takes are not integers, so it cannot be multiplicities. So it's very similar to the example I was giving. So you need a quantum correction to obtain the multiplicity. And this was a conjecture by Guillemin-Sternberg, but I would like to somewhat understand this theorem in context of any elliptic operator. So if you have an elliptic operator on a manifold, you have its principal symbol, which is a function on T star of M. And then you, if you have some invertibility property of the symbol, you can construct the Fredholm operator from the symbol. And the Fredholm operator is an operator such that, so these are infinite dimensional space of L2 function on M, but it has the properties that the kernel and the co-kernel are finite dimensional. And so you define the index as the difference of the dimension of the kernel and the co-kernel. And you can feel on this definition that it has a little bit of, you can move a little bit the operator D, and this index, which is an integer, will not move. I mean, first it's an integer, so it cannot move. But anyway, you have a well-defined index, which is an integer, and which depends on D only up to deformation. So that means you can deform the symbol, and you obtain the same index. So I recall Attila Singer formula for the index. The index of the operator D is an integral over T star of M of the Chern character of the symbol. This is a Durham cohomology classes, which is compactly supported if the symbol of D, if we are in the elliptic case. And then there is this Todd class of T star of M. And this is not, the Todd class is, that's why I call the, before the, why I call the operator before the, the Todd class is the same thing that I was doing before. It's the inverse of the function SHX over X. But here you plug the Chern class of the complexified tangent bundle. I work on T star of M. So T star of M is always even dimensional. So there is no problem. It's always almost complex manifold. And so you have this formula, which is valid for any elliptic operator. And so I just, it's a very remarkable formula. On the right, on the left-hand side, you have an integer. And on the left-hand side, you have an integer. And on the other side, you have a priori an integral. So this integral has to be an integer. That's why, for example, you can recognize that some manifold cannot be spin or something like that, is that you will compute this quantity, and you will see it's not an integer, and you will deduce that the manifold is not spin. So if we can do the same thing for a manifold with a group of symmetries, and assume that everything is G-invariant under a compact group, so I can make my operator acting on a section of equivariant vector bundle, and you obtain a virtual representation of G. So the index of D is this sum of representation. So here K varies over the irreducible finite representation of G. And P is a function on G hat. And so you can do that also if the operator of sigma of x of xi is invertible when xi is when the operator is invertible in the conormal space of the orbit. So in some sense, you can have maybe an infinite dimensional representation, but with finite multiplicities, provided your symbol has some kind of invertibility properties. So I give two examples. So one so I look at the complex projective space P1 of C. So it has, I act by just, so these are projective coordinates. So I act just by rotation under the arc 0, 1. And you look at the dual of the tautological bundle, and you look at d bar of Lk. So the section are the homogeneous function of in z1, z2 of homogeneous of degree k. So you compute k positive, and so the index you have just one function by z1 I, z2 k minus I on each. This is the wrong thing. It's u equals 0 e power I u. So I wrote my line bundle is Lk, but the decomposition is it should be a nu. This should be a u. Huh? So if you write this, so it has multiplicity 1 on each. Between u equals 0 and k. And so you can also write a compact formula for that, which is here it is Atiy Abbot fixed point formula for this very particular case, where you have just two fixed points and so on. So, and of course, so this is one of the representations you obtain by quantizing this Riemann sphere with symplectic form given by k times the usual symplectic form, you obtain this representation. And a simpler example, which I like, is L2 of S1, after all, is the quantization of T star of S1. And so here, the operator D is equal to 0, because after all, there is, you can take the D equals 0, because there is no conormal space. So you obtain care of D. This is transversally elliptic. When your manifold is homogeneous, transversally elliptic, you can take any operator. It will be always transversally elliptic. So you obtain L2 of S1. And here, the decomposition is... So of course, is Fourier. So the Fourier decomposition of so this is there should be some C. I mean, this is a character which is that. Huh? So so the L2 of S1 is of course decomposed in representation with multiplicity 1 and all the representation multiplicity 1. So in general, if we have a representation of group G with maximal compact group G with maximal torus T, then you can index the representation by a discrete subset in T stars. You look at the dominant weights. In fact, I prefer regular weights translated by rho, so rho plus P and regular. And so it makes a sense to ask if we can have, when we have a manifold M and an operator, an elliptic operator on M, can we describe the index of this operator by a piecewise polynomial function, so it should be quasi-polynomial function. And so I want to find this function. So I go back to the example two of S1. So it's not very difficult to guess what is this piecewise polynomial function that we want. Again, I have a multiplicity P of K, which is defined on a discrete subset. And I want to understand that this function on a discrete subset is naturally the restriction of polynomial function on T star. So we want to interpolate the function and to have something which comes from the geometry and which, when restricted to this discrete subset, will give you the multiplicity you want. So, of course, L2 of S1 is not very difficult to guess that the multiplicity function that you will take is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So to extrapolate it, it's not very difficult. You will take F equals 1. So after that, I will come back to the example that of P1 later, because so on. And so the theorem is that, in fact, it's true that whenever you have an elliptic operator or even a transversal elliptic operator on a function M, and here I took a simplifying assumption, because otherwise you have some problem with stabilizers. But anyway, you can give a formula in all the cases. So you have an action of G and M with connected stabilizer. You have the maximal torus of G, and G has the set of regular elements in rho plus T orthogonal. Then there exists a piecewise polynomial function F, which is anti-invariant by the Val group, which depends only of the K-theory class of the symbol of D, and such that this multiplicity is given by the restriction of this function. So we want to get from the symbol to a function on G star. So this is, I think it's an idea which is I mean, the multiplicity are a function on G hat. So I wanted to have the index as a function on G star. Let's say the K-theory part corresponds to G hat, and the cohomological part should correspond to G star. So here is a construction. So I think there is, it took me some time to decide that this formula was not good. So we had a formula with Nicole Berlin, which was a formula for the index of an operator, and which was a kind of interesting formula because it looks like it's a very good formula, but because it gives you, this is a formula for an equivalent index. You consider the representation. It's in some sense, if you think of representation theory, what is a representation? Is that a vector space? Is that a function on G, which is a trace? Or is that a function on G hat? So you have the three versions. Because you can think of a representation as a sum of vector spaces, and then that means you have to. You can think of the trace, which is a function on the group G, and you can take the decomposition of this representation, which is a function on G hat. And in some sense, it's not so easy to get from the character. If you have any formula for the character, if you think of Hermann-Weyl character formula and so on, you have nice functions for the character. How you get the multiplicities of these functions? It's not easy. So I want to say, to pass from one definition to another one is not so easy. So this is a definition on the group G. So this is a function, this is an expression for the character of the representation as a function on the group G. But in fact, I think it is better to try to have an expression on the Fourier transform side. And it's not obvious not of use to go from this expression to a function on the Fourier transform side, as you know, because and so there is an idea which I believe is very related to my first talk on splines, is that you do something very formal. Before you had this formula, which is annoying, because this function is not defined everywhere. It's if you look at this formula, it's defined only on the neighborhood of the identity, and then there are some poles on this side. So you just do like you do something formal. You just consider this function as a series, like I was doing for the inverting the splines. You just formally invert. This is Todd X, as we have seen, is product of the equivariant SH of CK over CK. So these are polynomial classes in equivariant cohomology. So you can invert and develop. And so you obtain like that a series of, in the equivariant cohomology ring, but polynomial coefficient. And then, if you do that, then it's defined everywhere as a series. So here, this is a series of form, and you can do the Fourier transform, and you obtain a series. So you obtain a series from, and if you look at this formula, the series of functions you obtain on the dual space, T star, it has a very nice property, is that in fact, they are polynomial functions on connected component certain complement of a set of hyperplane. They are polynomial, and after some, they are zero on this complement of, so you can define really a polynomial function which is piecewise polynomial by looking at this formula. You obtain naturally a quasi-polynomial function, and it's true that the index is a restriction of this series f of y to integers. And here again, you can go, I mean, to integers. I mean, here the integers are replaced by my group G hat. And it's true that you can go from any kind of limit. You obtain a well-defined function on G hat. So again, you look at these formal things, you invert, and you look at what happens on G hat, and it's correct. You get the multiplicity formula. So it's really the same theorem that I was giving for inverting splines. Exactly the same. And, I mean, the inversion of spline is like that. So maybe you are, so I want to go back to example one, because you may be skeptical about my formula, you should be, or at least. Because here again, I have a mistake. K should be, I mean, in this formula, it should be U. This should be a U. So you see that the multiplicity is 1, 1, 1, 1 on 0K, and then 0. So it doesn't look very continuous. But if you look at the formula that I gave for the infinitesimal index, it uses a T star of M. And so this is the formula that you get for my function, which was extending my extrapolation of this multiplicity, is by this formula. And it's a miracle. This is the formula is continuous. So if you, again, you get for any elliptic operator, you get a continuous function on T star, which is strict at integer to the multiplicity. And this is an example for P1. So, as I said before, we with the continuity processes and with the continuity and processes, we worked very intensively on a quite simple example: is G acting on a vector space. And in this case, we wanted to identify all possible. If we have a vector space and elliptic operator, then there is a well-known theorem which tells you that the K theory of T star of V, Kg of T star of V, this is a Bott periodicity theorem, it's a free module over R of G. But it's not true if you allow transversal elliptic operator. It's not anymore a free module over R of G. There is torsions. And we wanted to identify exactly what was the K theory of the zero. If you want, you have a vector space W with an action of G, an Hermitian vector space. You have the zero of the moment map, and you want to identify the K theory of the zero of the moment map. Unfortunately, we cannot solve this problem. But we can solve this problem if this Hermitian space is on the form V plus V star. So it's a little bit annoying, again, that we cannot solve the general problem of finding the K theory of the zero of the moment map for an Hermitian vector space, but we can do it for some spaces, and here, what this is one of the theorems we obtain. So we look at the torus acting on a complex vector space V, and so then G hat is a lattice. And we look at the list of weights of G on V, so it's a some. And if you have a function on G hat, we can do the difference operator. And so there is some terminology, which is if you take a sublist of delta, and you call it long. If its complement does not generate the vector space V, so that means there are many elements. And you look at the product of all these difference operators for over a long set of elements, and you introduce a space of function which satisfies the difference equation that lambda L of P equals zero for all the long subspaces. So this is a space of, so this consists of quasi-polynomial, not completely obvious. So that means it's a finite dimensional space, and you have an action of, it is invariant by translation, and of course it's a differential, and it is a space where you can compute the dimension and so on, and so you obtain the Damen-Michaelis space of the action of G on V. And it's, again, it's, you know the, and so this is our theorem for the case of a G action on a vector space. We look at the open subspace of the vector space V, where the stabilizer of the action are finite, so the orbits are, equals to the dimension of G. So the orbits are maximal, of maximal dimension. And the theorem is that the K theory of this strata open where the orbits are maximal dimension are canonically isomorphic to the space, Damen-Michaelis space of V. So there is a, here I didn't put the index, so it's zero or one, and it depends. Kg is a topological K theory, so it has a grading on Z mod 2, and one of them is zero, and it exists only on the parity, which is equal to the dimension of G. So you obtain a finite dimensional free Z module for even or odd, and the other one is zero. So again, the parity, there should be some index on. This there is an index here, which is the dimension of G, mod 2. And another theorem is that the index map can be completely, it's injective. This is V. My M is a vector space here. So the index map, in fact, here it's kg of zero. So this should be a zero, this should be V. So the index map from kg zero of T star G of V. So T star G of V is the zero of the moment map on V plus V star to the function on the lattice is an injection. And in fact, we can completely characterize the image by differential equation. And we obtain a module which is filtered by, there is one generator which generates a free module. And otherwise, there is a filtration by vector space which are stable by subtori of G. And the quotients are isomorphic to the Damen Michaelis spaces of these spaces, so on. And of course, here it's a special case, huh, because it's an action of a torus on a vector space. But so we can still do something when we have an action of a connected compact group on a vector space. But unfortunately, we cannot compute the K-theory over Z, which is annoying because in subsets computing, as you have seen, computing the K-theory or the index is approximately the same, so you don't want to have multiplicity up to, you don't want to have twice the multiplicity. I mean, you just want to have the multiplicity itself. You want to have a function on Z and not, you don't want to tensor with Q. So we know only over Q, and we know much less on all these things. We don't know enough elements and so on. So I hope that maybe we, at some point, we will be knowing more. But I think still this was some interesting things to relate K-theory to space of polynomials who were invented some time ago by people working in numerical analysis and which were used to approximate some polynomial, some drawing. So I want to finish this by saying a little bit in advance, happy birthday to Victor. And I like this picture, so I feel it's the idea of Victor coming from far and not needing much, you see? He doesn't need much. He just needs a small suitcase, and he comes from far with nothing in the hand except the hope to be free. So.